In our faith study today, I want to deal with how to counter Satan's attacks and win the victory, whether it's in healing or whatever trial you may be going through. There are many hindrances to divine healing, even when you believe in it. And here are ways to counter Satan's attacks and win the victory. First of all, know your position and authority in Christ and stand firmly on it regardless of the symptoms or how much the enemy may challenge your confession. This is Ephesians 2:6, where we're told, "And God has raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." Yes, claim your position and place of authority in the throne room with Christ Jesus. In 1968, I suffered an attack from the enemy of strep throat, and for 2 weeks I had to battle that as I kept up my meetings and kept on speaking, and I refused to budge from my position. I told the devil, "I stand on the word of God. I refuse to accept these symptoms," and in the end he had to take them off me. I never missed a meeting. No one knew I was going through a trial except myself and God and the devil. Now, the only way you'll know your position and authority is to know the Word of God where it's promised. Jesus said in Luke 10, "I give you power over all the power of the enemy." Churches are filled with Christians who are sick and suffering and many dying prematurely because they don't know they have authority over Satan, who's the source of sickness. And so they allow him free access to their minds and their bodies, to their homes, to their lives. Take, for instance, the big 250-pound bully who was drinking and entered a restaurant and began to use abusive language against the owner and pushing people around, and a little man didn't weigh over 160 pounds stood up and said, "Shut up and sit down." And this big bully, big bear of a man, turned to him and said, "Who said so?" "Well," he said, "I say so." And he pulled out his badge. You see, his badge revealed him to be an off-duty policeman, so the big bully grabbed his hat and left the restaurant. Now, that big man could have mopped up the floor with that little policeman if he'd wanted to. Why didn't he? Because he recognized his authority. He saw the authority of the city and state, even the nation, behind that badge, and so he respected that authority. The policeman knew he couldn't have defeated that man in a hand-to-hand conflict, but he knew his position and authority and stood on it. And Christians have the authority of heaven at their disposal, and they don't even know it. For example, at a charismatic conference where I was one of the speakers, I was waiting my turn to speak. I was sitting in the audience with a charismatic doctor, a doctor, by the way, who prays for the sick if they'll let him, a doctor who prays for his own needs and doesn't take medicine himself. And a woman, a charismatic, rushed up and said to the doctor, "Oh, there's someone back here that's had an epileptic seizure. Will you come and help them?" And so he rushed out and went back. He wasn't gone a minute until he came and got me. And so we went and cast a demon out, an epileptic spirit. I mean, what good is medical science against a spirit, a demon? He recognized that. He was a charismatic doctor. He knew there was nothing he could do to cure the man. And so we cast the spirit out. He was delivered and immediately got up and was all right. But the significance was, here is a woman, a charismatic, whose first thought in an emergency was run for the doctor, instead of running to God or to the Word or to some minister who had the faith for healing or deliverance. Oh, it's useless to hope to get people healed or delivered simply by prayer if they don't know the scriptures on healing or the authority they have over the devil. One brother tells how that he always gives a list of scriptures on healing to the people that he's going to pray for and requires them to read them before the meeting, before the healing service. He says, as a result, I get a large percentage of people healed. In one case, he said, of 28 stretcher cases, 27 got up and walked out of the meeting. They were healed. Another brother that I helped one time, way back in my early charismatic days, he gave instructions for an hour to a group of people on how to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so when 54 came, 53 received the baptism of the Holy Spirit as we prayed for them. And the one who didn't kept confessing she couldn't. Of course, you can't receive anything confessing you can't. I know in my own ministry, I've seen countless hundreds receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I always instruct them in the Word first, and as a result, 99% or more have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in new tongues. Satan will take advantage of your ignorance of the Word of God, my friend, when he can. One woman said to me when her daughter had been injured in an automobile accident and was in a coma, well, she says, maybe it's not God's will to heal her. Maybe he knows. He looks out there in the future and knows she'll backslide, and so he's going to take her home now. Oh, I said, sister, don't you believe that? I said, that isn't the Word of God. Never go contrary to what the Word of God teaches. He says that he promises to heal his children. Why don't you claim her healing? I said, never accept the fact that he's going to take a loved one home unless he gives you some special direct revelation that this is his will for this individual. You stay with the Word, and even a revelation's going to have to line up with the Word of God. Now, Job 1 proves that Satan knows that he cannot harm a child of God unless God permits it temporarily for some reason. But he uses the lack of knowledge of the Word of God in the hearts of most Christians to make them sick, to bind, oppress, and to kill them. Do not surrender when you're attacked, my friend. Confess the promises of God. God's not going to contradict his own word if you hold fast to it in faith. Confess your position of authority and stand on it. Ephesians 2:6 says you're seated at the right hand of God in the throne room, the position of authority. Believe that, confess it, and the devil will have to release you. Another thing, when you're sick or under attack, never speak of the sickness in the present tense. Never treat it as a personal thing. Treat it as a condition already dealt with by Christ at Calvary. 1 Peter 2:24, by his stripes ye were healed, past tense. Now many Christians do not realize the importance of a right confession when they're under attack. They don't realize they can bind themselves with the affliction they're trying to get rid of by speaking of it as a personal thing. They speak of it as my infection, my pain, my sinus condition, my heart trouble. That's like saying that it belongs to you. Now, even saying, well, I believe God will heal my arthritis, is still personalizing that thing and saying it's yours. No, as a child of God, it does not belong to you. According to Galatians 3, you've been delivered from the curse. That's a part of the curse. That sickness is not yours. Confess, this arthritis no longer is mine. Don't personalize it and say it's yours. Say, this arthritis, not my arthritis, it does not belong to me. Christ bore it at Calvary. It can't be on me if it was on him, and I refuse it. Now, some people do dig their grave with their teeth by overeating, but others are digging their grave with their tongues. Proverbs 18:21, death and life is in the power of your tongue. Now, the importance of confession is that it locates your faith. And you ought to confess certain things about the situation, what Christ has done for you. Confess he's provided healing for you in the atonement, as Isaiah 53, Matthew 8, 16, and 17 says that he has. Confess what Christ is doing for you now as you pray. He's healing me now, say. Confess what others are going to see concerning your condition, that healing will be manifested and you shall see it. Why confess its future before it occurs to your sight? Well, you don't confess you're going to be saved. You don't confess you're going to be made righteous. You don't confess you're going to be forgiven your sins. You don't confess you're going to get something like that from God. You say, no, that's already done. All right, the redemption is one work at Calvary. It's one atonement. And he's already healed the whole man. But it's not all yours unless you believe it. It's not all yours unless you confess it. It's not all yours unless you believe you already have it. One brother said to me, I'd like for you to pray for my sinus condition. Well, I said, is it yours? Well, he said, no, I see what you mean. It's not mine. I believe when you pray, this sinus condition goes. Now, that's true, my friend. Now, thirdly, learn the value of the power that's in the blood of Jesus. When Satan attacks you with some symptom or pain, immediately put that part of your body under the protection of the blood of Jesus and claim Christ's healing and the life of Christ that is in his blood. Revelation 12:11, they overcame him by the word of their testimony and the blood of the Lamb. The blood of Jesus has supernatural power to heal and to protect and to deliver when it's used in faith. Now, the blood in the Old Testament was a covering for sin. The term atonement literally means covering in the Hebrew. The blood can hide the sins from God, as it were. Well, it can also hide your home or your body or your possessions from the devil, in the sense that he can harm it, if you use the power of the blood as a protective covering by faith. When God sent the death angel through Egypt and told the Israelites to cover their homes with the blood, he said, "When I see the blood, I'll pass over you." And so you see, the death angel could not harm the firstborn of the Hebrews as he did the Egyptians, because he saw the blood covering them. It was their protection. It delivered them from the death angel. Pleading the blood in time of the enemy's attack is saying, "I'm covered with the blood of Jesus." And it's not just a figure of speech, but it's a true spiritual covering against the attacks of the enemy. Satan knows the shed blood of Jesus has power over him. He knows that that's what signified the triumph of Jesus at the cross over him. Now, the churches of our day sing, "There's power in the blood, there's power in the blood," but very few take the power that's in the blood by faith and use it daily to overcome the powers of darkness. Yes, the churches today do not realize really what they're singing. Now, though the churches may not know the real power in the blood of Jesus, make no mistake, the devil knows it. And when we cover ourselves with the blood by faith every day, that's the same as the Israelite putting the blood over their doorposts. It's protection. It's protection from the enemy. And when he sees that blood over your mind, over your body, over your family, over your home, that means the enemy must pass over you. Why, the reason many Christians are sick is because they've not been taught to use the blood as a covering. Why, yes, the power of Jesus' blood can be used in healing. We've seen miscarriages stopped, the bleeding stopped in arms where they were cut or whatever. We've seen people who couldn't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit immediately receive with the evidence of new tongues when we would plead the blood against whatever was hindering them. We've seen people delivered from accidents. We've been delivered ourselves from skidding on the ice toward a semi-truck or some danger or harm because we plead the blood of Jesus. God protected us. We cover our minds with the blood when we're under attack. We read in 1 Peter 18:19 the value of Jesus' blood. He says, "We've not been redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." And so the power in Jesus' blood is not to be limited to a once-for-all use as a covering for sins, but we are to avail ourselves of its life, its power, its protection daily. And so when you find yourself under attack, you can effectively counter Satan's attacks by looking your symptoms squarely in the face and calling it a lie and pleading the blood of Jesus against it. This is not denying the symptom or the pain. It's not denying its existence, but it's denying its right to be on your body as a child of God. You must stop Satan at the outset when you're under attack. And so plead the blood, for you overcome him with the word of your testimony and the blood of the Lamb.